So, had we fully covered everything in DBWA, like SQL injection and all? Have we covered all that? हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल? Am I audible to you guys?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay. So, what was the last topic that we covered?
I think it was SQL injection, sir.
SQL injection. Did we cover blind SQL injection?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
No, we have covered till the union statements, execution of union statements as SQL injections. I think so.
Blind SQL injection we have not covered then, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let's cover that then. So I believe that's the last topic that's left in DBWA. After that, we can basically move on to other topics. Let me just get this VM up and running and we'll continue. So did you try practice the previous topics in DVWA or even the ones before that?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. Are you facing any issues?
No, sir.
No. Okay. Good.
Injection. So it was working.
It was working. Okay. Nice. So even after we finish the course, you know, just keep in touch with the topics, keep going over the things, keep practicing commands like nmap at least, so that you don't forget what we studied. Because if you have a gap between studying and you don't practice it for a while, you can easily get out of touch with this stuff.
So I am actually practicing nmap on daily basis. Some two or three commands I am executing from nmap.
That's good. That's a very good thing. So that is for your own benefit. You will not then easily forget this. So that's a good thing. So keep practicing. And even other tools in other chapters, other practicals that we've seen, try to practice all of that, at least, to the point that you are comfortable with understanding what we have been doing in class. Service MySQL stop. So both the services started. Now on to the browser. So basically, so far what we've covered, that is normal SQL injection. Operator we covered the other day. Now let's come to blind SQL injection. Now if I enter a user ID, let's say 2, it's telling me user ID exists in the database, but it's not actually giving me the user ID. It's not actually showing me what the user ID is. If I enter a user ID that I know does not exist, let's see what I get in that case. Now we've seen that there are only 5 users, so user IDs range from 1 to 5. So if I enter 7, I get that user ID is missing from the database. Okay, that's all I get.
So this blind SQL is just like a black box testing kind of thing?
Somewhat similar, yeah, but I would not exactly compare it to black box testing, because black box testing means that you're going in without any prior knowledge of the thing, of the environment and the configuration, all of those details about what you are performing the test on. But if you're talking about this SQL, blind SQL injection, you are able to extract data from the database in this case as well, but in a different way. Now, blind SQL injection is more difficult to perform than normal injection, that I'll definitely say. And it is more time consuming even. But I'm not sure whether the comparison with black box testing would be adequate or not. I'm not really sure whether I should say that, because I don't think that's a valid comparison here. Because even in SQL injection, normal SQL injection, error-based SQL injection that we see, even that is not white box. You don't know anything prior to testing. It's just the results, the kind of results you see and the way you see them, that differs. Now, it's more difficult to exploit, it's more time consuming, but I would not make that comparison with black box and white box. When once we go through this, okay, then depending on what you think, you tell me whether you would say that's a valid comparison. Okay, let's see. So in blind SQL injection, we are not able to get the results from the table in the same way as we are doing in case of error-based SQL injection. So if you're getting an error, we are knowing that that's where we are making a mistake. Now, there are two types of blind SQL injection. And in this kind of injection, what we do is we run a statement, we run an SQL query. Based on the response that we get from the server, we figure out whether the query we are running is properly executing, whether we have run the correct thing or not. Now, when I talk about Boolean based blind SQL injection, so Boolean is true or false. So depending on the response I get from the database, I can find out whether what query I have written, whether that's true or false, whether it's correct or not. So that is what I'm going to do here. So in Boolean in blind SQL injection, an SQL query causes the application to give a different response for a valid result and a different response for a invalid result. You could say a positive response and a negative response. And we can also verify this. Now I know that if I'm using one, and one is equal to one. Now previously we used or, because we wanted it to tell us, we wanted it to see all the results. So that statement would be true every time. Now we are not able to view the results similarly. So what happens is, we are trying to verify that if I give a if I input a statement, if I input an SQL query, so the result that I get for valid query is positive and the result for an invalid query is negative. So I'm just verifying that. Now in case this is the payload that I'm entering, in this case the statement would be select whatever the columns are from the table where user ID is equal to one and one is equal to one. So what the AND operator does is it returns a positive response only if both statements are true. Now we know that one is equal to one is always true and user ID one also exists in the table. So I should be getting a valid response. Now I need an octothorpe to comment out the rest of the statement as well. So this is what I'm using to verify what I get. Okay. So in this case, my SQL query is returning a positive response. And I can similarly also test for what would happen in case I run a false query. So I could write and 2 is equal to 3. sorry, not 2 minus 3, 2 is equal to 3. Now we know that 2 is equal to 3 will always be false. 2 is equal to 3 is false anyway. So this query should not run properly. Okay, so now we see that it's giving us a negative response. And this is all it will respond to us. Okay, it's not going to give us any more detailed responses in case of a blind SQL injection. Now let's take a look at how we can use that, how we can use this kind of trick to extract information from the underlying database. So let's see. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to run some queries. Now for now, let's just forget what we saw in the previous SQL injection part, because okay, this is DBW is just for practice, but in a realistic situation, one website will not have both kinds of vulnerabilities. Either it'll have blind SQL injection or it will have error based SQL injection. So in this case, we are considering a website that has blind SQL injection only. Now the select statement that is running in the background, I don't know how many columns it has. Let's try to find that out. Union. I could also have specified this in lowercase. It does not really matter. This is a case insensitive language SQL. Union select one. So select one would be select just one columns. So if this statement runs, that means there is only one column in the previous statement as well. Okay, we got a negative response. That means there's more than one columns. Union select 1, 2. Let's try this. Now we get a positive response. So that means there are exactly two columns in the underlying SQL statement. Okay, that's great. Now this is also some information that we've gotten based on the kind of responses that we are getting from the database when we run our queries. Let's continue and run more queries, find out even more data. Now, in the SQL injection part, there was a variable which stored the database version. So, does anyone remember what the name of that variable was? It stored the database version. No. @ and version. This is the variable which stores the database version. Now I cannot simply run select @ version here. I cannot simply run this. It's not going to give me any results because we know this is blind SQL injection and not error based SQL injection. So again, I'll have to modify my query, and this time what I'll be going is I'll go character by character. Now the version information, we know that it's stored in a string. That's the version information is string. It's a combination of alphanumeric characters. We know that much. So what we are going to do is there is a substring function. Are you guys familiar with what substring is? Not just in SQL, maybe you've seen it in other languages. Substring. This function. Have you seen this anywhere? No. Okay. So see, what substring does is, if you give it a string as an input, and it actually takes three parameters. So the first is the string, which is the input. Second parameter is the position in the string, and third parameter is the number of characters. So now what it's going to do is, from this string, it's going to extract a part of the string starting from the position that you specified, and the number of characters in the string will be how, like, whatever you specify. If you just want to take out one character, you specify one. For example, in the word blind, okay, if I want to extract these two characters, so I would, for the substring function, this would be the first input, the word. Position would be 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, in this, as I'm talking about in case of SQL, in some languages the position start from 0. That's not the case in SQL though. In SQL, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, and I want two characters, so the last input will be 2. So the output for this would be the characters N, D. So is that clear?
Yes, sir.
So as I mentioned, we are going to check for each character individually. Now, what I meant by that is, for the version variable, we are going to check for each character. And the way I'm going to do that is, again, I'll compare that character with some value that I specify, and if it matches, I'll get a positive response. If not, then I'll get a negative response. So let us do that here. Now, in this case, 1, and I'm going to use a substring function here. So substring, and the first input will be, what will be the first input?
First will be the string itself.
So what is the string that we want to find out? We are talking about the database version here. So what would be the string?
It will be at that version.
Yes. That is, I accidentally just specified one. At the rate version. That is the input, the string that I want to consider. Now we'll start checking from the first position. So the second parameter for such substring function will be 1. And we're only checking for one character, since that's all we can do. Yeah. If you check for two characters, it'll get even more confusing. Now, I'm not sure why there are two of these. I should just have one. Okay. Now I'll compare it, and I'll compare it to one numerical value. Now this is an AND statement. So we should only be getting a positive response if the first character of version is 1. Let's see. Okay, so we are actually getting a positive response. That means the first character is indeed 1. Now let's check for the second character. One and substring double at the rate version. Now in the second position, I'll mention 2 because we want the second character from the version string. So the starting position for substring is 2. We only want 1 character, so the third parameter will be 1. Why don't I just copy this and submit? Okay, so user ID is missing from the database. This is a negative response. So we know that the second character of the version is not 1. Let's check if it's 2. Is it 2? No, it's not 2. And you could keep doing this, but here we know it's 0, so I'll just check for 0. So it is indeed 0 because we checked the version in the previous SQL injection part. It was 10 point something. So the second character is 0 and we have received a positive response in that case, which tells us that user ID exists in the database. No, I just clicked on submit accidentally. User ID exists, that means the second character is 0. Similarly, you can check for other characters in the string as well. And I know it's tedious, but with blind injection, that's the only way to get this information. So you can keep doing this for the entire version number string and for the entire version string. It's going to be a lengthy process, but what can you do? Now we take a look at the database name, actually. So for the database name, it's in this variable, database. Okay, so okay, there is a function that I didn't cover yet, which is length. Length, and this length function can be used to find out the length of a variable, length of a string. So in this example, for the version, I've checked whether the length is 7. That's not 7. Yeah. So the code for that was the string. So the SQL query for that was and length. And within the length parenthesis, you have as a parameter the variable you specify, which is version in this case, and the value that you're comparing it with. So if I say 10, I think even that is going to be incorrect. That is incorrect. Close to something like 20, I think. You can keep doing that for as long as you want until you reach the correct value. For now, let's check the length of the database variable, which holds the name of the current database being used. So one and length. Database is equal to, let's check for 3. copies, submit. So it's not 3 characters long. Let's check for 4. Positive response, that means the name of the database is 4 character long. Now again, if I want to find out what the name is, I'll have to start comparing individual characters. Let's start with that. Now, since this is a character comparison, I'll need to use single quotes. That's false. I should have copied that actually. Let's check whether it is B. No. How about C? Okay, one last time. Let's check whether it is D. Okay, so user ID exists. That is a positive response, which means that the first character of the database name is D. Similarly, if I want to check for the last character, since we know there are only 4 characters in the name, 4, 1 is equal to A. Okay, user ID exists, so the last character is also A. Sorry, the last character, not also A, last character is A. First character D, last is A. We already know the name of the database, which is DBWA. So if I do this for the third character, it's W. And the fourth character is V. Sorry, not fourth character, the second character is V. So DVWA, that's the database name. We were able to extract the name of the database using SQL injection the last time we saw it as well. But when it comes to blind SQL injection, it just is a lot more time consuming, and you have to be very patient. And also you need to make sure that the query you are writing is error free. Otherwise, for a negative response, you will not know whether there is an error with your query itself or the data that you're inquiring, or your query is syntactically fine, but the data that you're asking about is not present in the database. So in blind SQL injection, having your syntax correct is all the more important. So far everyone is on the same page, you're following along with what we're doing. It's clear what we have been doing so far. If there's any questions, then please ask.
No, sir.
No? Okay. Now, what we have here is, we've seen blind SQL injection, we have seen Boolean-based blind SQL injection. There is another way to do this as well. Another way to get information using blind SQL injection as well. That is known as time-based blind SQL injection. And it is known as time-based because now you're not looking at the result that you get, whether it's positive or negative. That's not what you're considering in this case. Now what you're seeing is you specify a time delay to the database server. You make it a part of your query. And depending on whether that time delay is being executed or not, whether there is actually a delay between you sending the query and receiving your results, depending on that, you figure out whether the query you are running is valid for the database or not. So let's try this out with a simple query. Info user ID is equal to 1. And now there is the sleep function. Basically, the sleep function, what it does is it tells the database to go to sleep. Not literally go to sleep. Go to sleep as in it will not respond. It will not process any queries for those 10 seconds. So it will stop all processing. So it would be similar to someone going to sleep. So let's say I say sleep 12. This should tell the database server to wait for 12 seconds before processing any queries. But it does not work. Why? Because I missed something that required in order for our SQL injection to run. I missed this octathor. Without this, the rest of the query will not be commented out and there will be an error. That's why we'll get the user ID is missing. That's why we didn't get any time delay. Now notice that even after I've sent the query, my browser is still waiting for the response. I have not yet received any response in this case. Okay, now I've received it. So after 12 seconds, I received the response because my query was correct and that 12 second delay that was preventing the database from replying. So in this case, we force a delayed response. And when this time delay, it expires when 10 seconds or 12 seconds, whatever you specified, when that time period expires, then you'll get the response that you want. So this is how time-based SQL injection works. Let me give you an example of that as well. Now we are going to make use of something of an if statement. So are you guys familiar with this? In MySQL, not if statement, in MySQL it's a function. So this is the syntax. If you specify a condition, if that condition is true, then the first parameter will be returned. If not, then the second one will be returned. So if condition and the first value is the value that will be used if the condition evaluates to true. The second is the value that is used if the condition evaluates to false. So we are going to make use of that. Let's see how that works. Okay, there's also another concept that I'm going to make use of. The like operator. So this is used for comparing patterns and it uses wildcards in conjunction with the like operator. So if you use the percentage wildcard, it represents any number of characters. It could be 0, it could be 1 character, or any number of characters. Underscore represents a single character. So select, the syntax will select column from table where column like the pattern that you specify. This will become clearer when you take a look at these examples. So in your where statement, you're saying that the customer name should be like a percentage. So after a, there could be any number of characters. So this will return all rows where the customer name begins with a. So finds any values that start with it, begin with it. In this case, it will search for any values that end with A. The third example, percent or percent. So just means that the character or should be somewhere in the middle. Not exactly in the middle, it could be at the beginning or at the ending as well, because the percentage sign can also signify zero characters. So this just signifies that these or should be somewhere within the name. It could be in the middle, it could be at the beginning, it could be at the end, it could be the only part of the value, like the value itself could be or. So all those cases would be true for the statement. Now in this case, the customer name like underscore r percent. So in this case, you're looking for a value that starts with some other character, has r in the second position. And after that, there could be any number of characters. So you need to have r in the second position. In the second case, you have a in the first position. And there are at least two characters. One is A, the other character we don't know. After that, there could be any number of characters. But we are sure that there are at least two characters, including A. Same thing in here, we have at least three characters for a word beginning with A. And in this case, we have words starting with A, ending with O. Any number of characters could be present in the middle of it. So I'm going to make use of this in the next statement that I write. So the next statement, I'm going to make use of that. So now the statement is one, and if now I'm going to be running the same thing for checking the version. If double at the rate version like, using the like operator now, let's see what the answer would be if we do actually give it the statement like the actual version name. Now it starts from 10. We know that first character is 1, second is 0. So like 10. And after that, I specify percent. Then it should sleep for 20 seconds, let's say. Otherwise, we don't want it to do anything. I can just write null. And of course, the octathon. Okay, so it is not responding. I think it is sleeping for 20 seconds. That means our statement is true. So the database number is like this and database version number is like this. Now, if I turn it into a false query also, then I will have you notice the difference. If I just say if version like 10, then it's not going to have a delayed response because that statement is incorrect. So this is how I can make use of time-based blind SQL injection to gather information from the database. And for the medium and high levels, it's just a similar procedure for medium and high levels in basic SQL injection. Uses for medium, you need to use Boxu. For high, you just have a separate window that's open. So, any questions at this point?
No, sir.
No? Okay. So, try to do this if you have the time. Try to practice. And if you